not wealth. I wrote a paper last year that was published in a book from Cambridge University Press on poverty, and I think I was the only person to suggest that one of the questions was a nonsensical question. Among the questions that the authors were asked to address is, what is the cause or what are the causes of poverty? And I said, this is a meaningless question. Poverty has no cause. It's what you get when you fail to produce wealth. In contrast, wealth is not what you get when you fail to produce poverty. Right? These are not somehow logically equivalent. It's like having a science of darkness. We want to study darkness. What is the cause of darkness? And we could posit dark particles or darkons or some sort of occluding substance in the air. In fact, the scientific approach is to say, what is the cause of light? And Sir Isaac Newton and Euclid and many other writers helped us to understand light. Darkness is just the absence of light, and poverty is the absence of wealth. So let's look at how people lived through most of human history. This is based on the statistics from the Danish statistician Angus Maddison, who's the late statistician, a wonderful social scientist. And he took a world per capita income averages based not on, again, memoirs of rich people, but trying to understand how normal average people actually lived their lives, about $3 a day in contemporary terms. You notice from the year one, it's just a flat line moving forward. If you look very closely, you can see there's an increase in the 13th century. And this is world average, not just Europe. There was also a rise in wealth in parts of Asia and the so-called Middle East, and as well as Europe, a decline during the general crisis of the 17th century, which again was a kind of a world crisis, not only European. And then something astonishing happens. About the year 1800, a little bit earlier in Britain and the British North American colonies, it begins to turn almost vertical. So the question is, what is it that needs to be explained? That horizontal line, which if you point it back is going to be pretty flat going as far as you want, or the last 200 plus years. In other words, we lead lives that are almost unrecognizable to the bulk of the generations of the human race. To imagine, if you will, that Julius Caesar somehow were transported through time and had a meeting, an appointment with George Washington. There would be some differences in the world, but he would have found it largely understandable, navigable. He would have traveled there on a wooden vessel in the ocean, propelled by wind or by human power, oars. He would have then traveled on a horse or some horse-drawn carriage to George Washington's home. They would have had dinner illuminated by candlelight. There would have been some differences, like mechanical clocks that were available at this time, but otherwise generally understood. And the food would be prepared and served by slaves. Now move forward just some decades. Now he's going to go across on a steamship, travel on a railroad, move forward a little bit further, no slaves, it's all free voluntary labor. Move forward a little bit further, the note would have been sent by electrical impulse, by telegraph, almost instantaneously saying, let's meet. Then they would have moved forward a little bit further, they would have dined by electrical light. And then imagine today, they'd send each other text messages, communicate by tweets, meet each other on Facebook, and so on. In a short period of time, the world becomes unintelligible, in effect, to those two people who shared so much, although they're separated by about 1,800 years in time. Their worlds are quite recognizable to each other. Our world would be very difficult for them to navigate in. So the question is, what is it that makes this possible? And that's what my book really is about. Free market capitalism, which has transformed the world in ways that have produced wealth unimaginable to the richest people of the past. In fact, if you think about it, the wealthy of the past, very few people today, even very poor people, would trade their lives for the lives of Louis XIV. You think, wow, fantastically wealthy person. Well, read the accounts of him having dinner and the wine freezing in his glass. The chemists here know how cold it has to be indoors. This is at the dinner table for your wine to freeze in the glass. They didn't have central heating. They didn't have air conditioning. They had many slaves and servants, vast palaces that were built with compulsory labor or taken through a tax money stolen from other people. But they didn't have the conveniences that no poor person would be willing to tolerate, the absence of which no poor person would be willing to tolerate today. If you would want the dental care that they received, in fact, just go back 30 years and ask who would want the dental care that was available to the richest people in the world at that time. Not me. I actually do remember it. And it was certainly far inferior to what we have today, which is now much more widely available. So that the modern world is radically different from previous generations. Now, what accounts for this? Deirdre McCloskey, who is an economic historian, calls this the big fact, or the great fact, rather. And this book I very highly recommend. It's a wonderful book, Bourgeois Dignity. It's a volume 2 of 6 from University of Chicago Press, but mercifully you can read it on its own. You don't have to read volume 1 or volume 3, which will be appearing soon. She has an essay in the book, The Morality of Capitalism, that synopsizes rather neatly her basic thesis, although she doesn't go through all of the economics and economic history. So delightful book, well written, very rigorous. And one of the things I liked about it, I learned a lot from it, she goes through every theory of economic growth and asks, can it explain that chart? Can it show how the world was changed? What was different? Either it explains some growth, but not enough. So even theories I found very congenial about extent of the market, rise of international trade, and so on. She says, look, do the arithmetic on that. That will get you an increase in growth. You'll get a doubling in 100 years. You won't get 8 times or 10 times during that period. It is insufficient to explain it. And she has a really remarkable approach to this, which has to do with the change in society, respect for the freedom of producers, entrepreneurs, to innovate and to keep the profits that they made. She has a delightful quote. I've not been able to track down the original source of it, but from Joseph Schumpeter, an economist I greatly admire, that the world became, in Europe and North America, a business-respecting civilization. For the first time, commerce was considered honorable. In the past, in all previous civilizations, merchants, entrepreneurs were considered somehow dirty. There's the tradesman's entrance to the Lord's home. It's shameful for them to come in the front door. Instead, the way you achieved honor was by being a warrior, which is to say, killing other people, or by being a religious figure, so attending to the spiritual needs of persons. Those were considered the two paths to honor and glory. And producing wealth, being an entrepreneur, taking things from one place where they're inexpensive to another place where they're expensive, and getting the arbitrage, the profits from doing that, was considered demeaning somehow beneath dignity. And that began to change. And she argues, I think very persuasively, that this was one of the great elements in the transformation of the modern world. Now, the key to that is to understand incentives. This is something that I think is often poorly understood, and people jumble together a lot of things. They confuse intentions and consequences, for example. If the intention of someone is noble, well, then the consequences will be just fine. But of course, that does not begin to exhaust the discussion. I'm actually not that interested in the intentions of other people. If I want to be friends with them or have intimate relations, their intentions do matter to me. Otherwise, I don't really care. I don't really care that people who destroyed millions and millions of lives in attempting to implement their vision of society were well-meaning. It's of really no interest to me whatsoever. The fact is that these kinds of visionaries have killed so many people by attempting to impose them on society. I'm more interested in the consequences, what happens when you implement this or that policy. And behavior is shaped at the margin. This is something economists understand. It's a very important principle. It's that additional increment of inputs or outputs that matter when human beings act. And that is shaped, our behavior is shaped by incentives. This is understood by some people, let's say socialist-oriented people. They do get it. That's why they keep wanting to put people in prison. When they say punish these people, imprison them, they're talking about incentives, right? If you hit them, beat them, put them in a little cage, they may change their behavior. But their understanding of incentives is very, very limited to only those negative incentives and not the whole range of incentives that help to shape human behavior, including such things as social expectations of other persons, feelings of friendship and cordiality, wanting to fit in, and also being rewarded for good behavior. There's a wide range of human motivations, and a care for incentives should take all of those into account. Those people who are insisting we should impose 100% taxation on people who earn incomes above a certain level should really ask how long they're going to continue to do that work in exchange for nothing. Will they be able to put in the extra hours? How many firms are going to be set up where people are pouring in the so-called sweat equity if they realize that above some certain income level, there'll be a 100% taxation? And you might be surprised, who would actually advocate that? I could give you lists of academics who do advocate this very robustly and strongly. Think about John Christman, who's a leading intellectual, a very smart person, who thinks there should be 100% tax on profits. Profits should be taxed 100%. His argument being, in models, perfect competition models, this is how a little bit of knowledge can do a great deal of harm, he looks at models of perfect competition as articulated by economists. By the way, I don't subscribe to that as a useful model of economic behavior. But he looks at that and he says, in a perfectly competitive economy, profits are zero, right? Because there's no uncertainty about the future. All profits are competed away. And his response is to say, and that's a perfect economy. So if we reduce profits to zero, it'll move us toward a perfect economy. And I confronted him once at a conference after he had made this case, and I said, well, let me just put it another way. It's also true that in the perfectly competitive model that you're drawing on, that has, in my opinion, very limited heuristic use in social science, and otherwise is extremely misleading, as this example and many others demonstrate, the demand to hold real cash balances will also fall to zero. Why? Because in the parameters established by that model, there's no ignorance about the future. So what would happen? No one would hold cash in their wallet. So look at this. I have cash here, right? A couple different currencies in my wallet. Why would I do that? Well, the reason is I don't know when I'm going to use it. I might have to take a taxi someplace, make some purchase on the street. That's why I carry cash, because of uncertainty. In the model, there's no more uncertainty. The demand to hold real cash balances falls to zero for the simple reason people would invest all of their money to earn interest and to reach maturity at exactly the moment they had to spend it, right? That's how that would work. So why don't we abolish money and see how effectively the economy works then?